مصلحا ومجددا. فارنوا بنذر طاهر وجنان.
Assalamu Alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuhu, dear viewers. With us today, we have our beloved brother Stephen from Belize. I had the blessed opportunity to do dawah with brother Stephen in 2015. And today we will, inshallah, hear how he accepted the true Islam, Ahmadiyya. Assalamu Alaikum, brother Stephen.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
So the first question is, what is your name and background?
Okay, well, my original name, like you said, is Stephen Gab. However, after I wrote, well, I joined the community and I wrote to Huzur, I told him my backstory. He said that my name should be Attaul Haqq, the gift of truth. So in regards to joining Islam, Ahmadiyya, I guess many people know in Belize that I was an artist, a poet, a little bit famous. I don't know if people would know Sean Paul. I opened for him in a concert. And I was living somewhat of a high life in my country. You know, I was a local, you know, celebrity, you would say. Been on several TV shows and all of that. Now, before I joined Islam, Ahmadiyya, there was this place called the Belize African Connection, and that's where I was introduced to Islam, not Islam Ahmadiyya, but Islam in itself. A sister called Sister Fahima, she introduced me to Islam and spoke to me very shortly about it. And she said that, you know, Islam is peace, and, you know, a lot of people don't know about Islam. And for a long time, I wasn't really, I was trying to look for a spiritual aspect that I could agree to, because Christianity didn't really bring satisfaction to my heart because of the fact that, you know, the Bible and science don't really mix, you know. So that really did not attract me to Christianity. And so after I gained my associate's degree, I didn't really mess with spirituality. But until I met Sister Fahima, she told me a little bit about Islam. And the first phrase that I learned in Arabic was "A'udhu billahi min shaitanir rajim." And she said that I should say that once I'm angry. And I was, you know, I got into an argument with someone. And I was riding my bike, and I was just saying, "A'udhu billahi min shaitanir rajim." And before I met them, I just felt calm, right? Because I had an argument over the phone, but when I was writing to them, I wanted to continue the argument. But after using that phrase, I calmed down. But yes, I was living the high life, and there was a person that, from the Jamaican artist named Alkaline, that came and was about to do a show here, and I was supposed to open for them. That night, some people, you would say, wanted to rob us, or just wanted to, you would say, jump us, like just beat on us. So the next week, I wanted to go and retaliate. Some of my relatives here, they're known gang affiliates. So I wanted to kind of take my revenge. And before I could do so, my brother Musa, he brought me to the Ahmadiyya mosque or mission house. The Murabi Khalid was the one that introduced me to Islam, Ahmadiyya. And I did not think I would learn anything new. I thought that, you know, it would be just like Christianity, just a bunch of fairy tales. But when I heard that the Quran says that, you know, the earth and the heavens were one mass, and it expanded the like the Big Bang theory and it talked about evolution, these things attracted me. And it was what got me into Islam, Ahmadiyya, and you know, all of the beautiful arguments from the promised Messiah alayhi salam, and the story of the Holy Prophet alayhi salam. You know, there was a time when I was in my apartment, and when I was going in my apartment there, I was reading the life of the Holy Prophet alayhi salam from the second Khalifa, and I got to the story of Taif, where they pelted him with stones until he bleeded, and his beautiful response of, you know, when the angel asked him if they could destroy the village, and he said that no, the descendants of these people can become Muslims. And so these things really attracted me to show how much mercy and love Islam has, and how logical it is, you know. And the same brother Musa is the one that gave me the idea to become a missionary. Both of us were supposed to become missionaries, but sadly he was not able to go. And it's like a foreshadowing, because I went to Ghana, which is a country in Africa, to learn about Islam, Ahmadiyya. And my first encounter of Islam was the Belize African connection. So it was like just like a foreshadowing. And even my name is Attaul Haqq, and that is the gift of truth. And the name of the music group that I was in was called The Truth. So it's an amazing thing that God, you know, knew everything and planned everything before I even knew what I was getting myself into.
MashaAllah, brother, really inspiring. So the next question is, before Ahmadiyyat, what were some of your beliefs and how did they change? Like, as a Christian, what did you believe before leaving Christianity, and how has Islam changed your life?
Well, basically, I was not a person that really had much of a religious belief. From a young age, I was very curious about spirituality. My grandfather was a Jehovah Witness, and he died a Jehovah Witness because, you know, they don't believe that you should take blood from anyone. And so that was his belief, and he died for it. So my aunt gave us this book called The Book of Bible Stories, and I would read that book 3, 4 times, 5 times. So I was familiar with the prophets of the Bible, and I always wanted to, you know, I always said that if I was born in the time of Jesus, I would accept him. And I wish I could meet prophets, or I wish I could meet a prophet, you know. So I dabbled in Rastafarianism, Buddhism, a lot of different religious sectors in Christianity, Catholicism, Adventists, and all of that, Methodists. You know, I was just trying to find a place that I could feel comfortable. But before I was a Muslim, or I became an Ahmadi Muslim, I was agnostic. And what changed in my mentality is just my ability to understand the world and the logical proof of God, and the morality of my life has changed tremendously. I feel complete. Before, when I was doing all of the music and all of these things, I didn't feel like a complete person. I felt like something was missing in my heart. Something was missing. But now I can lay in my bed, and if I know that I did what God wanted me to do for that day, I am quite content and I am satisfied. Before, I could never do that. Because, you know, here in Belize, it's very, very common for someone to, you know, smoke marijuana or you know, drink alcohol. That is a norm, you know, and I cannot say that I wasn't a part of that norm, right? But now that I see, you know, the it's like I'm changing, or I have changed since I've become a Muslim.
Brother, the next question is, how did your family react when they heard that you have accepted Islam at Ahmadiyya?
Well, that's a funny story because, well, my brother has always been a person that would, you know, tease me, and my friends too. You know, they would they say Allahu Akbar, and they would say the guy would, you know, they would call me a terrorist, you know, and they would call me Aladdin. I don't know why that was something about a genie or something like that. And my mom, she thought that I was going crazy. You know, she actually thought that, you know, she always would sit me down and say, are you sure? Are you okay? Are you sure you're okay? You know, because they knew that I wasn't much of a religious person. They, when they, because the radio stations here, they're mostly Christian. They would play some Christian songs and I would just scoff at it. So they were just, my mom was concerned with my mental health and my friends were just, you know, making fun of me.
Okay, brother. So now, since we know that you're active in Tabligh and Dawah, for the viewers, if you can tell them how they should do Tabligh to non-Ahmadis, mainly Christians, what arguments did you find most effective and how are you doing Dawah in Belize and what has the response been?
Well, the fact is that, you know, when it comes to Christians, I would recommend that you only use the Bible. Don't go into the Quran or anything like that. If they're interested in Islam and all of that, of course, you should go and explain to them a little bit about Islam and all of that. But if you're going to try and, like, tell a Christian about religion or anything like that, just show them the truth of Islam through the Bible. Right, show them the truth of what you believe through the Bible. That's what I saw. Not only it works a little bit here, but it worked really greatly in Ghana. That's how they got so many people to convert, especially Christians. Right, but also what I see is that if you give people a little bit by little, this like, you know, spoon feed them the information, you know, and utilize social media. Since I've been here, I've used social media as much as I possibly can, especially because of the COVID-19 situation, the pandemic situation. Using social media, making videos, small videos, and just being out there, when they see you doing something and being active, they definitely will ask you questions.
And apart, like even from the books of the Promised Messiah, we see that he would use the Bible, and through the Bible, he proved that Hazrat Isa was not God, nor did he die on the cross. He survived and died naturally later. So this is some really important advice for all the viewers. The next question is, if you can shed some light on the importance of Khilafat.
Well, I can tell you that throughout my life, I've never felt a relationship with such divine love than that of the Khalifa. Since I've even been a Ahmadi Muslim, I can see the great difference between me and a normal Belizean, right? Because they're moving throughout their lives trying to find the answers, trying to find leadership. Me, as an Ahmadi Muslim, I already know who is my leader and what my beliefs are. You know, I don't need to be searching for anyone to lead me or to find the answers, because the Khalifa can give me the answers. And it's something that, you know, it brings me closer to God, you know, and I can see that with the guidance of Khilafat. Because each and every Friday, it is, if you have a problem and you look at the Friday sermon, sometimes he just says something that, like, like actually applies to your life, or it helps you to better your own situation. And you never knew that it would come up in that way. So I've met Huzur about 3 times, and each and every single moment I can feel that that divinity that he holds, that relationship that he has with God. You know, it's such an aura that you could never really replicate, you know. And I the first time I met him, I thought that, you know, it would be very serious and he would be a very serious person because it's Islam. Islam is a very rigid religion. But when he saw me, he spoke to me in Urdu, and I said, I don't understand. And he said, oh, I thought you were a Pakistani because you look like a Pakistani. And everyone started to laugh in the room, and he was smiling as well. And the tension went out of the room. Like, now everyone is familiar with each and everyone, and we were like friends from birth, you know. So the divine guidance of the Khalifa is what I see, and the mercy and the love that he has for us, you know, no matter what, you know, he will always be there, and he's like a father to us all.
Jazakallah, brother. So now, alhamdulillah, you're a murabbi. You've completed your jamia studies. So what's next? What are your plans for the youth of Belize? How do you plan to bring them to Islam Ahmadiyyat? And what response have you gone so far in regards to this?
Well, being a murabbi is a very big responsibility, as I can definitely see for myself. You know, everyone looks at you as a person that is the representative of the Khalifa. What I have done with, I have just focused more on the Qadam. I want more Belizeans to become missionaries. So I am working with those younger 11 to 16, you know, and I involve them in Tabligh. Right? That's my goal. Involving them into the Tabligh, to understand what Islam Ahmadiyya is. And I tell them that if you do not know something, you cannot love it. So that is why I am very much, you know, strict on following Tarbiyyah and teaching them what the promised Messiah said. And, you know, the information, it is so much information that I got when I was in Ghana that I want to share it, like, at 1 second or every single session. I want to give them so much, but I only can give them little by little, you know. So I'm going very, very slowly with them. But my thing is, like, you know, very innovative, very, very innovative methods of tabligh. Like, I did ice cream in Islam, you know, where we sit with people, we give them like a cool coffee, or, you know, just some ice cream, and we just discuss Islam while we're sitting with each other, you know. And there's different things that we can do to reach out to them and to make them feel comfortable with us.
MashaAllah, ice cream and Islam. I've never heard that before. Really creative. So brother, if you can give some more tips to the viewers of how they can help other Ahmadis do tabligh, and what works best in countries like Belize and other small countries, or even in the West, what tips would you give? And also, if you can tell us how the response has been to your tabligh in Belize. You guys do radio shows, you do many other amazing initiatives. So if you can shed some light on that, and have you faced opposition in Belize as well?
It's a funny situation, because even before I entered Belize, I came in third in my class in my first year of Jamia, and my country, they put it on the news, and they usually use Facebook a lot in Belize. So what happened was that they put it on a Facebook page or a news page or something. And literally, people were just saying a lot of bad things about me, and say, don't come back home, you know, Even when I was in London, the month that I was supposed to return, they still were saying, "Don't come home, stay there. You're gonna bring Sharia law and all of these things." So that's just ignorance. People don't know that much. People just follow what the media says, and I don't blame them because even before I was a Muslim, that was what I believed, that Sharia law, woman didn't have rights and all of these different things. And what I believe is that you find ways in how you can have a conversation with them. In all honesty, flyers are good. Flyers are a good way to just give them small information. But I feel that I want to have a one-on-one connection with people. That's why I came up with the idea of ice cream in Islam. And I just copped the idea of I am a Muslim, ask me anything as well. From Canada, it's a good idea. You have small videos. You with interactions of a person asking a question, because some people will not want to speak to you. They're shy. We have went to universities. Go to the schools. Ask them, do they have any kind of theological course? Tell them that we can tell you more in Islam. We can give you more details on Islam. Yes, we do have the Ahmadiyya Basketball League here as well. It's a very good initiative, or a very good way to introduce Islam to people, not in regards to what the league is, but it's just a means of showing that Islam is not only about the theological side, it's also about the moral side as well. So our biggest thing is to show people that, Muslims are not what you think. Muslims are not what you think. They're not just people that just go in a mosque and put their heads on the floor 5 times a day. The Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, has said that if you pray 5 times a day and you do not do any good work to back up your faith or your worship, then it's for nothing. So you must do good works, and that's what we in Belize do our best to uphold. So each and every news media we try to call into radio stations. We try to once we have an event, we call the news media and say that we're going to have this event, please cover it. So we have very good relationships with the media houses. We have 4 missionaries right now. Even the missionary from Orange Walk, he's doing some great work. He did a radio show today, and they're asking him to go on a television show. So slowly but surely, people are understanding that Islam actually means peace, and Muslims are not terrorists. And that is how we're getting to break the ice. That's the first thing that we did. We just let people understand that Islam is not what you think. Then you can get into, oh, the Messiah has come. Oh, then you can get into the deeper parts. You just have to let them understand that Islam is not what they think.
Jazakallah, brother. So now there are also some viewers who are atheists, and they're looking for the truth. Their background is sometimes Christianity, sometimes Islam. So what would you suggest to them? What books of the Promised Messiah should they read? And what would you tell them? What should they do to find God? How did you find God? And what should they do? As many of them are into such things as well, like music, etc. They don't want anything to do with religion. So if you can give them advice, because you've been where they've been.
Yeah. Well, for me, once you want truth, it's in Islam, Ahmadiyya. There is no other place that you can find truth. Like I said, the Holy Quran gives a Nobel Peace Prize winner of the Ahmadiyya community, Dr. Abdus Salam, said that, I believe he said that the Quran is 1/18 scientific, right? And he said that he based his whole Nobel Peace Prize win or his research on what the Holy Quran says. So the fact is that what attracted me was science, the word of God matching the acts of God, right? The promised Messiah also was not a person that removed himself from science. And that was what Islam really attracted me to. The fact that, you know, science and Islam are not like far apart. If you do the research, Islam gave a lot of contributions to science, you know, in its golden ages, you know. The fact is, like, even surgical blades, a Muslim made them, you know. So it's so many different things. And the fourth Khalifa, his book, Rationality, Religion, and I can't remember exactly the name, but that book is full, chock full of scientific research and evidence to back up what religion is. And why one should believe in God. You see, the fact is that, you know, we look at different things in life, like, for example, the phone in itself. And you see the phone and you say that, okay, it served a purpose and it was created, right? And it is not self-sufficient. It needs something. It needs electricity. And it's the same with us. You know, we know for a fact that we were not created out of nothing, right? Or we were created out of nothing, but God was the one that, you know, helped or actually made that situation occur, right? I was reading a excerpt out of a book, especially the rationality from the fourth Khalifa, and in it, it says that this scientist said that if anyone believes that the whole universe was just created out of random cause, it is like one is saying that a printing press exploded, and out of that explosion, encyclopedia came into existence. It doesn't make any sense. How can that be? How can that be? And even an encyclopedia is not as complicated as the universe in itself. You know, in order for even a scientist to create the bacteria that was once, you know, us, they have to use so many different scientific tools. And just to create that space or that area that could hone or allow that bacteria to grow. So how is it that the universe, which is, according to them, so very random, how was it that these delicate bacterium were able to survive and thrive and evolve into intelligent beings such as ourselves? You know, so if you want to find logic, if you want to understand what religion is and to understand who God is, then you definitely need to find you need to look into Islam Ahmadiyya, and you definitely need to read the fourth Khalifa's book and listen to his question and answer sessions. It will blow your mind and it will open your mind. If one truly wants to find truth, sincerely, without any bias, then you will find it nowhere else except in Islam Ahmadiyya.
Jazakallah, brother. So everyone should try and check out the book Revelation, Rationality, Knowledge and Truth. Brother Stephen, how about for the Christian viewers? What would you tell them? Why should they accept Islam and Islam Ahmadiyya?
Okay, so now that's the fact is, right? The Ahmadiyya Muslim community, It gives you a wonderful understanding of Jesus. And it does not tell you to remove yourself from the love of Jesus, but it tells you the truth of the mission of Jesus and who Jesus was and what he stood for. Without any type of regret or any type of shyness, I can say that I love Jesus more than any Christian because I know who Jesus truly is. I know that Jesus was a person, a man that was a prophet, and came to save his people, to give the message of God to the people. So, being that I understand who Jesus was, and it's not even according to my own understanding, it's the fact that Jesus said the words that I believe in. Because I don't disbelieve in the Bible. I don't disbelieve in Jesus. If you want to have a true understanding of Jesus and what he stood for, then read the Promised Messiah's book. Jesus in India is the best book for anyone to read. That is definitely the first book I would tell anyone. If you're a Christian, read Jesus in India. The fact is, that for example, where in the Bible it says in Matthew that Jesus said that the sign of Jonah, that they were asking him for a sign, and he said that though the people do not deserve a sign, that they will find the sign of Jonah. Just like how Jonah was in the belly of the whale for 3 days, I will be in the belly of the earth for 3 days. And the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, he was so gifted by God Almighty. Because I can tell you that I've read the Bible so many different times, and I never thought of this aspect. I never ever said that, oh man, this is different. So he, like, literally it was like a veil that came off my eyes when he said this, and he said that this shows that Jesus didn't die on the cross. Because what is the sign of Jonah? What is the miracle of Jonah? The miracle was that he did not die before he went into the belly of the whale, and he survived being in the belly of the whale for 3 days, and he came out alive as well. That was a miracle. So when Jesus said this, that means that he was not crucified or died on the cross. Because if he died, then he would be categorized, na'uzubillah, as a liar. God forbid. So it is quite obvious and quite clear cut that he did not die on the cross for anyone. And this is where my Christian friends or my Christian brothers and sisters, they need to research more. It is not enough for you to just live your life and believe that, oh yes, I'm doing good, it's okay. You understand? It's about understanding what life is. It's about understanding what you're doing in your life. You can't say that, oh, I'm a believer or I'm a Christian or I'm a Jew. Yes, you can. Anyone can say that. Even I can say, yeah, I'm an Ahmadi. But what am I doing in order for me to have a good relationship with God? Am I following what my religion says? And if I'm following it, what is the logic behind my religion? Can I defend my religion against someone that debates me? I can say that for myself, that as an Ahmadi, if anyone even brings the Bible in front of me, a Christian brings his Bible in front of me, I can defend my religion without any shyness or any fear. I can, if any Christian comes in front of you, especially as an Ahmadi Muslim, do not go by anything except the word of the Bible. Do not accept anything except the word of the Bible. Tell them that I will only discuss the topics of Trinity, sonship of God, a sonship of Jesus, and atonement and all of these different things only according to the Bible. The words of the Bible, the words of Jesus Christ. Because if you do not do so, then you will have a fruitless argument. So always take everyone to the word of the Bible. And that is where that's what I learned in Jamia. We had debates amongst ourselves. One would pretend to be a Christian and I would be the Ahmadi Muslim. And John 20:17. How can Jesus say that I am going to my Father and your Father and to my God and your God? If he is God, why would he say my God? And if he actually is saying that, if you're really believing that Jesus is the physical Son of God, he said my Father and your Father. So that would mean that you are also the physical son or daughter of God. And this is not... The viewers can look it up. John 20:17. It's clear cut. So if you want evidence, Islam Ahmadiyya is the place.
Jazakallah, dear brother. Really inspiring words. So you gave a message to atheists and Christians. So now if you can give a message to the non-Ahmadi Muslims, why should they accept the promised Messiah, alayhi salam?
The Holy Prophet said that when the Imam Mahdi and Messiah comes, that you should give him your salam, even if you must crawl over your on your belly over ice on the mountains. So why should I even tell you why you should join? If you are a Muslim, then you should follow what the Holy Prophet says. That is your obligation. That is what you should do. That is, he's your prophet. So if you have any sort of love for the Holy Prophet and you want to actually understand what Islam is, then Islam Ahmadiyya is where you should be. I looked the other, on your show the other day, a guy that was totally anti-Ahmadiyya. You know, and he gave so much proofs, and all of his sheikhs and all of these people, they couldn't give him answers. You want answers. People want answers. And the only person that will not ever, ever, ever try to be understand Islam Ahmadiyya is a person that has a heart of a rock and a mind that does not want to be unlocked. So He gave the message to those non-Ahmadis a long time. He gave the best message. I can't give it any better than how he gave it. His whole story was about how every single other sect of Islam did not show him the truth of Islam. The fact is that the Holy Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith that the 72 other different sects will be away from him, and one will be the true Islam. 72 different sects said that Islam Ahmadiyya is non-Muslim in Pakistan. So they agreed that we are non-Muslim, and they fulfilled the prophecy of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. These are the words of the Holy Prophet, not us, that we're fabricating anything. We're not using any kind of situation if it's the words, it's just like the Bible, what Jesus says. That's what we use, the words of the prophets. We don't use anything else. So, like I said, if you want to follow what the Holy Prophet said, if you want to follow what true Islam says, true Islam is nowhere else except in Islam Ahmadiyya. You are obligated to accept the promised Messiah. You are obligated to give him your salam. If you want to find God, the only place you can find God in this is in Islam, Ahmadiyya.
Jazakallah, dear brother, brother Attaul Haqq from Belize. I really enjoyed that story, and I pray that Allah continues to guide the Muslim viewers and the non-Muslim viewers to the true Islam, Ahmadiyyat. Once again, we thank you for your time, brother Attaul Haqq.
Jazakallah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
If you have not yet subscribed, make sure to subscribe and click on the bell icon so you can get notifications for every new video. Also, make sure to like and comment on the video and follow on Twitter and Instagram.
Sayyidina, salli ala Muhammadin.